So today's agenda, we're going to talk about two things. First, we're going to review where we are in the budget at this time based on all the budget requests and how they sum up and the deficit and then some potential modifications. And then once we run through that, the second piece, we're going to talk a couple issues on the November bond offering. I think we're going to talk specifically about communications, you know, pulling together data. Secondly, we're going to, I think, come back and revisit the issue of what we think should be included in the November bond offering is maybe what some things we talked about maybe shouldn't be in. So those are the two things that we'll talk about for the bond offering. All right? Yep. Okay, so everybody has this handout? All right, so let's run through the expense budget request. And what I've listed on this page are the groups, departments, elected offices who have budget requests in excess of their target. First is the assessor register at Beads, who came in $254,000 over target. I think Diane addressed her issue why, you know, and I think this is mainly driven by increases in headcount and compensation. 911 communications is $68,000, and what this is, we had that discussion and there was a request for five additional headcount, and then we went and had a meeting. Patrick and I met with the city of Omaha with Marty and Steve Curtis, and we went over it and we kind of came to agreement that if certain of the items in terms of mobile radios and fire were included in the bond offering, that then the city would agree to this additional headcount with the provision that we agree that we would target this headcount, these five positions, to start April 1st, 2017. That's why it's only $68,000, because that's in our budget, that's only 3 months. And the city said, you know, for their budgeting purposes, if we could work it out this way, they would do it. So that, like I say, just assumes the five positions would start April 1st, 2017, and the city agreed to it. The county attorney came in $213,000 over target. The capital improvement fund, if you remember last year, internal audit said that when we came in for a request on capital improvement, we should put in a request of all needs. And so that's what Jerry and Jeff did on capital improvement. You know, last year the amount that was in the budget that was approved was $635,000. It's been that way for the past few years. So they came in at $1,008,119. You know, the budget had originally went out, I think, with the 635 in it. So that's why it's so much over target.
Oh my God, I'm sorry.
The election commissioner came in $2.9 million. You know, we had just when we originally did the target, we didn't take into the account that it was a general election year. Their budgets always go up significantly in a general election year. So they came in at 2.9. We'll come back to that when we go through specific potential modifications. County court, their request is about $180,000. Remember, they came in, Leslie Douglas, and the judge came in to talk about it, where it's a combination of having to need to redo their courtrooms down there, along with increased attorney's fees. The sheriff came in $397,000 above. If you see footnote one, there's $119,000 or about $120,000 in offsetting revenues. So the net unfunded piece is about $277,000. Treasurer was up $117,000, and that's due to kind of the one-time cost incurred with their big project down there about converting all their systems to the Oracle system and bringing in a consultant and kind of redoing their whole bookkeeping within the treasurer's office, which is a big project, and so that's why they're over. Administrative was over $184,000. $55,000 of that, the net unfunded piece is for the PIO position. The rest of it is really from an increase in the community-based aid grant program, which has offsetting revenues. Employee fringe benefits we had originally targeted that they would be flat, but they're going to be $1.2 million over, and that's just basically driven by increased health insurance cost. Our experience this year hasn't been that good, so the projection we had from Aon in terms of health insurance premiums is the primary driver behind employee fringe benefits increasing that much. ENSA, well, this is really, in the budget, it's combined ENSA, Region 6, and this ENSA was flat, but Region 6 is up $295,000. Maybe I'll let Mary Ann speak to why that is.
At Region 6, it's by law that we have to match a certain amount, whatever amount the state gives us. For every $3, we match a dollar. And there are increased dollars that are coming to Region 6, so the counties then divide that. The formula to figure out which amount each county owes historically had been by valuation, and we started to look at the other regions, and many of the regions do it a multiple of ways, but they're by valuations and population. Some just do valuations, and so we did a 50-50 valuation population, which increased Sarpy and Douglas's portion of it, but it was a little bit more fair to the rest of the smaller counties. And what
did you check in with Turk to do that?
No, I didn't. But anyway, so the majority of it is because we're getting more money from the state, and in order to get that more money from the state, the formula is we match it by law.
The finance director from Sarpy did call me up and told me they're up over $100,000, and so he was saying, "Are you guys up to?" When I told him, "Yes, we sure are."
All
so.
Of them would be.
But that means their funding is going up too for the region.
Right, exactly.
I mean, that's a good thing.
That's a very good thing.
Absolutely.
Very good.
Okay. Corrections. Remember when Dr. Foxall came in, he kind of presented, he's about $1 million over target based on some of his assumptions there. Outside office is up about $50,000, and that's due to the incremental rent that we are paying for probation offices. I think, where was that, Jerry? There were two new ones that we had to get for?
Yes, 73rd and Blondo and 84th and Spring, 83rd and Spring.
So as you know, as the amount of probation officers has increased significantly, so has their need for office space, which we're responsible for. Next is juvenile justice collective impact. It's up $128,000, but the way we work juvenile justice collective impact, none of the funding is assumed to come from taxpayer dollars. There's like four private foundations that contribute to fund it along, and then the county is supposed to pay 20%, but we've got that to be covered through the community-based aid grant, so that's up, but that's funded. And so we went through all those, then all the other offices and departments in the county, if you sum them up, you know, they came in actually a little under target, and basically they all came in on target or about flat, but it's close to $1 million less, and that's driven primarily by juvenile court, who, you know, came in and reduced their request or their budget from last year by over $1 million just because of the actual experience this year. So if you sum it up, the total general fund expenses were, you know, close to $5.7 million above target. So if you go to,
Go ahead. I wanted to ask, some of these really are not exactly, you know, like 911 communications. Is it safe to say that the budget request is $6.3 million? Is that shared by the city or just
85% is paid by the city.
Okay, so 85% of the request over target would be the city too, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
Well, see, that's why I don't know that the, and there's about two, three, four, five others that have those kind of quirks. Is there any way to get to a plainer figure, or are you going to get
I'm going to kind of get to how I get to make it work where it'll take that into account.
Okay.
Yeah, on corrections, that extra $1 million.
Yeah.
Do you want to just talk about why the full million in your estimation? I mean, salaries,
you know,
is part of it.
It's salaries. It was opening, you know, with his assumption that how full the jail would be, and some things that he wanted to do. You know, when I come back to it, I don't think he needs the whole million in my mind, but that was, you know, and typically that's how we work with corrections, is that they'll submit a number and we'll kind of think about it and give them, you know, majority what they ask, but not everything.
And I think on the election commissioner, we get a good amount of it back.
Yeah. Well, we'll go through that one too. These are all in my.
Yeah.
So. Any other questions before we go to the next?
I asked about corrections to the city, pays a chunk of this too, don't
they? A little bit. I mean, and that's in your revenue number, but.
Okay. I'll let you go into that.
Yeah. So. Revenue projections, environmental services, you know, they always come in. I talked to Kent. He was, you know, while his expenses were about flat, he decreased his revenues by about $250,000, which he said was a very conservative number. So I talked to him. He thinks that, you know, when we're looking for money, that we might be able to take that back. Now, the election commissioner, to the point you just made, Mike, their projection for revenue was $354,000. So, but in the last two general elections, the revenue that they actually booked, the actuals, was $560,000 in fiscal 12-13 and close to $800,000 in fiscal 08-09. So that's something that I think we really have to drive in, and I have to probably go and meet with Brian on, because if you just look at these numbers, it looks like that number is probably lower than it should be based on historical experience.
Well, a lot of the times they can't pass the expenses on, like in county offices. I don't think they bill the county, do they?
But do you think it should be different than it was 4 years ago?
I'm just wondering what did change, but I don't know. Some of these things, it may have changed, but some of the offices they can't bill for. If the city has an election, the city pays the whole election, and they charge SIDs, and they'll charge, you know, schools or rooms and so forth. But the general election ballot, they can't charge anybody on it. I don't know why the difference.
And I have to sit with him, because just when I look at this number compared to where it was the last two general elections, it seems low. And then public properties was $60,000 lower than a year ago. But this year, the actuals year to date are up about $3.4 million. So I talked with Jerry a little bit yesterday, and he thinks we could add the $60,000 back on the revenue side. So now we get into the net deficit or surplus calculation.
I'm sorry to interrupt you, but shouldn't corrections be in here too, on the same page, revenue?
When I went through it, I thought their revenues were okay. That
Okay, so these are just
changes.
Aberrations or changes?
Yeah, those are just changes.
Okay, thank you.
So back to the deficit calculation, you can see a year ago right now, when we did this, we adopted a budget of $260,000,086. These are, and this is just a part of the budget that's paid for by property taxes. So it's the general fund plus, you know, the debt plus health department, health service, community services, veterans. So just the amount that is paid through property taxes. So we had a total expense budget of about $261 million. And you could see net, when we did it, it came out to a surplus of $270,000. But a year ago, when we were at this table, the budget that we agreed to was a $1 million deficit that we would assume that we were funded by general reserves. But what happened between this time a year ago when we adopted the budget and when the final property valuations came out from the assessor's office on August 20th is the final taxable valuation was $788 million above the budget estimate, which generated a $1.2 million in incremental revenue. So we went from a net deficit of $1 million to a surplus of $1.2 million, and that was driven by the fact, if you remember last year, the taxes that went up were on commercial property, and through the whole Board of Equalization process and the referees, our experience was better than we thought, so that the final accepted value that came in on August 20th, like I said, was $788 million higher. So net, when we did the final state book budget, we had a surplus of $270,000, even though when we did the adopted budget, we were assuming we were going to use $1 million of reserves. So that's what happened last year. So this year, if you sum everything up, our requested expenses are $280 million, which is a 7.4% increase over a year ago. Our projections for revenue from these property taxes, general fund departments, the health center, sum up to $276,000, which is a 5.7% increase in revenue. So expenses, as requested, are higher than revenue. So the number that we're looking at right now in terms of a budget deficit is about $4.2 million. And so that, as we look at it, is what we need to discuss, is ways we can go back and address that budget deficit. Any thoughts before?
I can't wait to see what you have come up with, Joe. It'll be the first time I've seen it.
I'm surprised you have your back.
Yeah, you should have your back to the door. Have your back. Sit. You should sit on the edge where PJ's sitting.
Doug wants to tell us how to do that.
Yeah, well, actually, Jeff and I are meeting this week. We're going to, every year we do what we call a white paper, and we have suggestions for budget cuts. I don't have it with me because it's not added or completed, but just off the top of my head, I can tell you one thing. In here you have a request for a public information officer.
Yes.
And that's something which we think you could easily dispense with.
We figured that you only deserve the best person to communicate with.
Well, we figure that county board members all have mouths, they can be their own public information officers.
Some pretty big ones.
All right, if no one else has anyone else, what I did with Patrick's assistance
this really is
for discussion purposes only. This is kind of, you know, one approach to get there. Let me take you through it, see what you think. Like I say, I'm just throwing it out there as a basis of discussion.
Can you hand this out, Joe, if you have it?
There's not a, no hard copies of this one.
He doesn't want hard copies.
Nope, nope.
That's going to say.
So on the revenue side, like I said, environmental services, I talked to Kent Holm. He said he could live with increasing their revenues $250,000 to make it flat. The election commissioner, you know, if you go back to those numbers, you can, I thought that compared to prior history, you know, when he said we were at $350,000, and then 4 years ago we made $560,000. I said, can't we assume that it would be flat to what it was 4 years ago? And this is something that, like I said, I would go and talk to Brian. So that $200,000 is revenue to the election commissioner is to bring it flat to 4 years ago. So I talked before Jerry, and I talked, and he was willing to be a little more aggressive on their revenues based on how this year is coming out. So if you add those together, we could get about $510,000 in increases from revenue projections.
Okay. I'm getting to the good part here. That's your message.
All right. Now, expense decreases. Capital improvement, I said, you know, just given the situation we're in, I assume that, you know, this year's budget was $635,000. I said we could bring it up to $700,000 and try and live with that, which would be an expense decrease of $1,119,000. The election commissioner, I think his budget of $2.9 million, I think the last general election was $2.3 million. So I kind of used a number of, okay, you know, increase it to $2.5 million and decrease the expenses by $400,000. Again, that's something that I'm going to have to sit and go through Brian with, but if you just ran the trend analysis, it would seem like that $2.9 million is higher than it should be. Employee fringe benefits we could reduce by $250,000, and that has to do with changing the portion of the insurance premium that the retirees pay. Right now, a retiree family pays like 35% of the total cost. This would up it to 50. I think a individual by himself pays 20%. This would increase it to 35. And this is kind of consistent with the original plan here on retiree medical, is to, you know, gradually up the portion that they've been paying. And we haven't upped it for a few years after the lawsuit, which we, you know, prevailed in a pretty strong fashion with, so we absolutely have the ability to make this increase if you so choose, and that would be worth $250,000. Corrections, you know, he asked for $1 million. You know, like I say, it's always a give and take with Mark. I think if he, you know, really sharpened his pencil, he could probably live with about $700,000. So that would be a $300,000 reduction. The assessor, register of deeds. You know, we had this is kind of what happened last year. Diane wanted more money, and, you know, our position was that, you know, the merged organization, while we're not asking them to cut cost, we weren't really sure why costs should be increasing. And at that point, so this recommendation basically says keep them to target. The sheriff, this is the money, the unfunded portion of the request for increase, which they said historically was funded by the drug forfeiture fund. And the point here is that there is still money left within the drug forfeiture fund that could fund that $275,000. So, you know, in a tough year like this, if there's money in that fund, why not use it? County attorney, I think Don asked for like $217,000. This was kind of splitting the difference with them, giving them a $117,000 increase and reducing it by $100,000. County court asked for $180,000. Some of it was for postage or some others. I think there's room there that I think they could live with $150,000 increase, which is, in my mind, fairly generous. But you can make an argument that money is definitely needed in that group. So you add all these up, and the expense decreases come to $2,724,000. So with the, and if you add the revenue increases and the expense decreases, it sums to $3,234,000. So you go to the next page. You know, if it's a $4.2 million deficit, and you take back through the modifications $3.2 million, you're left with about a $1 million deficit, which is what we did last year. And so my recommendation was that this revised deficit could be assumed to be funded on a preliminary basis from the existing general fund reserves. And, you know, that way we could do it. And that way is how I kind of get to a budget that would be funded.
Joe, could you go back to that previous page for a second, please?
Monitor giving us the raspberry.
So anyway, that
it's
Jim's phone. This is, you know, so I ran it up the flagpole. Now let's have some discussions on it.
Well, I think you did a good job. You let Jim go first, but I like your idea totally. I don't want to take more than a minute.
Well, I have my idea too.
Yeah, now it's his idea.
It's a bad idea. Jeez. It's inexcusable. Okay, that's my comment. Jim, first.
Yep. Thanks, BJ. Okay. The capital improvement, which seems to be the bulk of the add back, is they ask for 1184 and we take back 1119. First of all, what's in the 1184?
Yes. A lot of
why don't you come up to the table because we're on recording?
Catherine, you should come up here.
I don't have it in front of me, but there's a lot of mechanical, electrical upgrades, more energy efficiencies in the for our facilities. That's driving the pricing, and I believe it's 1.18 for about 4 or 5 years out. We've been limping along at 6 something for quite a while, and
you know I think the same amounts roughly were requested last year and the same result essentially happened last year. I don't know how many years we go back, but this is like deferred maintenance type stuff. I mean, we got to do this sooner or later. We got to do this, and we're not doing it. Am I right there? I mean, that's my impression having sat through a couple of these.
That's notes. Correct. At some point, we're going to really pay for it to catch up. Or something's going to happen and
sure.
We're going to have to reach into reserves.
And knowing that, you know, hopefully we're going to have a substantial bond issue to do stuff like this at corrections, would any of this stuff be a fit for the bond issue? Rather than just kicking the ball down the road year after year after year, can we fold some of this into the bond issue?
Well, with the corrections number
right.
in the bond
right.
of $7 million as of right now, that would take off some of the money that you would have put into your cap.
I think we figured $1 million over the 5 years.
Yeah.
That was contributed to the correction out of the $1.8 million per year.
Okay, so in this package, you know, in your capital improvement request of 1184, are we talking like 200 of that is correction stuff?
I didn't bring that down with me. Well, maybe.
Well, we don't have to get it today, but what I'm saying is, if we can lay off some of this deferred maintenance, which we're going to have to do sooner or later anyhow, it doesn't get any cheaper, into the bond issue, how much of that could we do? It also saves us from property tax impact of those expenses in large extent, because we are more effectively financing it through the bond issue than we are through direct property tax expenditure.
I found that.
Okay. And like I said, we don't have to do that today. All I'm doing is putting out that for, you know, discussion purposes. I think we all want to get to the same place eventually, and that seems to be the big dog on this plate every year, kind of. So, I mean, if we can do something there, we can do something there. The other thing is, and I just throw this out there for informational purposes, you know how I can be a little obsessive about looking at things over a long period of time, backwards, and try to go forwards from that. A couple of these documents go to what we've been talking about, and Joe's been very helpful in trying to get us to an exact number. Relative to the reserves, which if we take this scenario, we do about $1 million out of the reserves at the end of the day. And last year, Joe, we did something similar.
Yes.
Yeah. So trying to capture what is that number that we're drawing down on, the first document that you see that reads across goes from the second to last line, the unassigned general fund amount, which presumably is approximate with our reserves. Was there enough for all the commissioners to get this?
No.
Here.
There you go.
Then you go from 09, where that number is 45 million, to 15, where that number is 56.5 million. As near as I can tell, and Joe, correct me if I'm wrong, that's kind of the reserve number.
That's not the reserve number I use, because that number includes, the reserve number I would use at June 30th would be about 32 million, and this one includes the inheritance tax, which is I think about 14, so that would bring it up to 46, and then there's something else that they throw in there, but that, when we look at our funds, that's not what we consider the general fund. This is the number out of the CAFR, where they add together a few funds, and you know, like the restricted fund in there, the 23 million that's thrown in that. That's the employee insurance fund, which they throw here into the general fund, but you know, we don't throw into the general fund. So when I look at the general fund reserve at June 30th, 2015, I think the number was about 32 or 33 million. And what you have to take into account is seasonality. So, you know, the fund goes way up based on the property tax collections. So right about, you know, at the end of April, we're hitting our high point for the year. So at June 30th, this is still kind of a high number. And we always hit our low point on, you know, February, March, right before the March property tax proceeds. And so when I went to the pure general fund reserves, this year we hit our low point on Monday, February 29th. We had $12.3 million left. And that 12.3. I'm always managing that time of the year, and at that time of the year, I'm slow paying the quarterly payment to the building commission, and a fair amount of money to .com. So if I weren't slow paying, that number would be under $10 million. So when we get, so that's my cushion. When you get to the low point, I would say it's the number I work with is about $10
million. Okay. All I'm looking for here is an agreed upon by all branches of county accounting number that we can go forward with. And obviously, we're not there yet, but we could get there. So somewhere between what we're talking about in terms of your accounting number, 32 to 33 million, and what this seems to reflect, which is a 56 million, somewhere there's a number that we
can
all agree.
Like I say, within the CAFR, there's certain funds that get added into the CAFR. And like when I talk to Moody's and Standard & Poor's, there's the thing that's the statutory account, which is the CAFR account, as opposed to the report I worked off of, which is what I call the management account. And the management account is when I get a call that there's insufficient funds or somebody can't pay a bill, it's this management account that the clerk's office is calling me about, and that's when I have to transfer funds or whatever. So that's why I work off this account, because if this account, any of these funds go negative, boy, you know, then we're not paying. The clerk's office says we can't pay.
So if I'm understanding you right, this number is the CAFR number.
Yes.
Okay.
That's the CAFR number.
This is the number that Standard & Poor's looks at.
Yes, for the most part, yes.
Okay. So our AAA bond rating is in part based on this number.
Yeah, in some respects, although they always look at that number in terms of, you know, they look at that number as a percentage, and then they also look at what do you do every year in terms of having a balanced budget. And, you know, I can tell you that when I have the discussions with them, they are really centered in what they'd like is kind of would go into more your this general fund history is that, you know, every year for, you know, at least about the last 5 years, we've been able to keep, you know, $1-2 million we come in above with our revenues greater than our expenses. So when they see that we're running a balanced budget and actually contributing a little bit to the reserves, that's what they always talk to me about, what they feel comfortable a bit about Douglas County with.
And I think they also mention our responsible approach to our underfunded pension obligations and some of these insurance fringe benefit questions. And they like what we've done in the past.
Right.
To stay on top of that. That said, then we get to the second document, which is the general fund 11-year history, which shows a positive balance at the end of every year. Is that right, Joe?
Yes.
Okay.
At least I think for the past 4 or 5 years, net-net, you know, we've come in a bit positive. You know, if the general fund has a $190 million expenditure in the year and we're coming in $2 million positive, you know, that equates to about a 1% favorability. So yeah, we're coming in favorable in that 1, maybe 2% range.
Yeah, sure. So just to take the most recent year, 2015, the expense budget was $179 million and change. The actual expense was $175 million and change. The year-end balance under was $4 million and change. And that's, you know, not out of line if you go back 10 years. I would imagine if you average those, it would be almost in the $4 million. There's some that are lower. There's a couple that are higher. But it looks like 4 and something is the norm.
Well, not quite. You have to look at the numbers, because if you took it for 10 years, that would say we have a $40 million reserve, and our reserve last year was really more about $32 million. So, and what you got to remember is also during the course of the year, we take our adopted budget and we approve it, and we have two supplements during the course of the year. And so we'll typically during the course of the year increase our overall budget by maybe that's, you know, 2-3 million of that. So that, okay, boom, this is it at this point in time. But over the year, when we do those two supplements, we're eating, you know, we fund some of that out of reserves so that when you get to the next year, that whole 4 million might not be there. In my mind, it might be more like 2 million.
So to give us a fair and accurate picture, we'd have to do this, go back and do what you're just talking about, the supplemental factored in, which would offset this number by some number. Mm-hmm. Could you do that for us?
Sure.
What I'm saying is, this is an array of numbers now that we have. You know, 32, 33 million, 48.8 million, 56.6 million. Somewhere in there is the definitive number. And it's important to know that definitive number because, you know, the good news is we're not only running a balanced budget, we're running at a relatively healthy surplus budget year after year after year, and have been for a decade at least that I've been able to find. What that surplus is what I'm trying to get at here today. And I, Joe, I appreciate your help on this. You've been informative and open to my inquiries on this. That's, I think, an important number that we need to come to definitively. So that when we're talking about, okay, we need to take a million out of this, we have, or another number out of this, we have, what's going to be the balance after we do that? I think that needs to be done before we, you know, cross that bridge.
Mark, yes, on the lighter side. So you're saying you keep two sets of books?
The statutory books and the management books, right?
Okay. Jeff, one of the big expenses is chillers. You had, if I recall, either 3 or 5 large, very expensive chillers that are at or beyond their life expectancy. Is that correct?
Correct.
Are those for the 24/7 operations?
Yes. Health center.
Health center? Okay. And we'd be in big trouble if one of those went up, wouldn't we?
Yes.
Is there any alternative to replacing the chiller?
Not in that building.
What about the correctional facility? How old is their chiller? Is that one of those on the list?
I don't think I had one of those on the list.
Okay, that's
but
good.
To catch up on the year total for corrections is about $172,000.
Okay, because I hate... We ever since I've been here, we've cut the capital improvement. That's 8 years. You can only cut so much before you run into a catastrophe. Then you've got to work like heck to remedy it, whether it's a burst pipe or a chiller that goes out in a very critical place. What about the youth detention center? Do you know about that chiller?
No, youth center is pretty well under control because they renovated most of it, so I'm catching up on the old stuff.
Okay, because I don't want to catch you back that far. Now, if we were to take it out of, you know, we're talking general fund reserves and the inheritance tax reserves. If we were to take what you need out of the inheritance tax reserves, it still affects the CAFR, which is what the bonding agency looks at, correct?
Yeah, and the issue, you know, in most years, you know, this million here or even an additional million we can cover out of inheritance tax. But this is a once in every 13th year where we have 27 payrolls instead of 26. So each payroll is worth $5 million. So what I've had, the assumption in this plan, and I saw this coming for a couple of years, so I built up the reserve in the inheritance tax. So if you look at the transfers, there's $5 million coming from the inheritance tax to the salary adjustment fund that's going to fund that 27th payroll. So that makes this year tougher to go back and ask for anything over the inheritance tax, because the way... I put the deficit together. We're, if you include the $500,000 that we send to UNMC, The inheritance tax is projected at $14,500,000 in outflows, and I think we're projecting $12 or $12.5 million in inflows. So that means this year already we're using $2 and $2.5 million of inheritance tax reserves to fund this budget.
Okay. That brings up another point, Joe. The salary adjustment fund, that's the raises fund, right?
Yes.
Okay. And last year we did our budget and everything, and then in December we did another salary adjustment for a certain class of employees, which added over and above the budget $1.5 million or something.
Well, last year we put in the salary adjustment fund $1,750,000, and then I think at the end of the day, when due to timing and these other things, we were about $120,000 short. We did that as a supplement in May. So this year I see more coming. So I've increased the salary, pure salary adjustment amount from $1,750,000 to $2 million.
Okay. And what are we seeing coming that adjustment is requiring?
There are some settlements to, I was looking at which union contracts are gonna settle. And then, the plan assumes 3% overall. But then there's also some potential money in there. I was a little more conservative. I don't know what we're gonna do with the salary adjustments that the public defender asked for were, they weren't 3%, I think they were over 6%. So that's an incremental amount. So that's, I just kind of looked at these things and I said $1,750,000 wasn't enough this year. Given what's out there, I think we should be more conservative and put $2 million in.
Okay. We're not anticipating another end of year increase like we did last year for the non-union employees. Is that being anticipated in this?
No, I've never anticipated that 4%. I've always funded it at 3%.
Okay, so you anticipate funding it at 3% in this package. So if we were to approve another 4% at the end of the year for those employees, we would have to add back.
Depending on timing, but that would be a potential factor to have make an adjustment to the salary adjustment. Yes.
But if we don't do that, if we just stay the course with the existing recently settled collective bargaining agreements and what we know is coming down the line, we're okay with this in terms of raises.
We should be. 2 years ago, at the end of the year, we had $180,000 left over, and that automatically goes back into the general fund. This year we had to add $110,000, so we're always close. And like I say, it always gets into this timing when we have to do these retroactive settlements where you go back to a period of a prior fiscal year, which I think this year we might be looking at that already on 9/11. When did that expire, Marcos?
I mean, it expired December 31st of 15.
So we're so 6 months into this year that we're going to have to fund next
and
year.
And
we can't accrue salary. And so that's the tricky part, is the timing between fiscal years. It's, you're not exactly sure what's going to work out. But when I put the $2 million in there, that's my best assumption that we should be okay.
And that would give us a cushion to do this new agreement with the 911 employees.
Yeah, because there might be another contract that doesn't. We're always lagging on that. If we could make this where we settle the union contracts the day they expire, this would be much more of a science. But when you don't do that, it's much more of an art.
Gotcha.
No, I'm good.
Anyone else? Okay.
What's your reserve? It's 900 and something. 900,000, what?
Which one?
Then your reserves.
Reserve's 30.
Reserve, I'm...
No, I mean that you're going to balance it.
Yeah, $1 million.
What if you just put it to an even million and put some more back in capital?
Say Yeah.
14,000, yeah, I mean.
We'll take it.
A couple of shingles on the roof.
Couple of shingles.
Jerry,
I mean, I don't know what his word
is. We always had this issue, and then internal audit came in and wrote that paper, and they said everything, you know, on your wish list that you need, put in to your budget request, right?
Correct.
Because you guys historically have come in, and if it weren't for that, you would have never asked for $1.8 million, would you?
Oh,
well,
we knew better. The following we knew better year. Than to ask for it.
Chris,
how many one-time costs are in the budget?
Well, the biggest one, the one-time cost, is the $5 million additional payroll.
But it's not one time.
Well, it's once every 13 years.
Oh,
because
okay.
It's a 20.
Is it 13 years?
Oh,
okay.
Man, so big.
I know, and that's why, you know, you got to see it coming for a couple of years, so we'll pay for it this year, and then by the next one, I'll be gone, so I'm not going to worry about it.
Be careful what you wish.
So, I'm just...
13 years from now?
I'm fine with, you know, I don't want to blow it off, but, like, at some point, we got to commit to knocking this out. And
if you guys really think we're really shorting the capital, we could make the that we could take $1.5 million out of reserves and give 500,000 more to.
I mean, I know you don't, but
I mean that's your.
I would agree with that. Actually, would because I've always been concerned about capital that we just keep kicking the can down the road.
Mm-hmm.
And I agree.
But I also get very paranoid about our bond rating, particularly in a year where we're going to do bond issues. So that extra 500,000 actually would be greatly appreciated.
Yeah.
So
I agree. The only thing I can do is be careful where we're going to spend that and have discussions and not do it too soon because we don't really know what's going to happen on the bond issue, and we've got to make certain that we have those priorities, Jerry and Jeff, to be really cautious that we're spending the right place. I don't want to be changing air conditioners just because the life of them's gone.
No.
But they're still working.
Yeah,
but I do have a concern about the plumbing and some other things at corrections.
Yes,
that becomes more of a priority. So I think what we ought to do is not decide today, but look at it carefully and get your thoughts and judgments, because I respect, you know, you've been through a lot of this, so see what happens first.
Well, I'm assuming you all got our non-bond stuff.
Estimate.
Correct.
I think you'll have to.
Well, there's 172,000 worth of work in corrections that would go to the bond if the bond passed.
That would go to
year.
It if it passed?
Right. It would be taken out of.
It would be, okay.
Taken out of the cap.
And if something happened, you could put that back. Could you, I mean, we'll work with it to put it back in.
We'd spend it in a different way.
If you increase,
there's always a need for it.
There's a need. There's air handlers that are.
No, that's fine.
There's a bunch of stuff.
But there's not a lack. I'm just saying personally, I'd be fine with that because that's the only part I don't feel comfortable with putting like off because, for instance, if for some reason this bond issue doesn't pass, we faced with a whole nother situation.
Right.
Which is going to be a lead deal somehow.
There's a good chance of that.
Yeah.
We'll
so
be talking about the bond shortly. Marianne, you had a question.
Would you go back again and in the bond issue, if we include it for corrections, it's $7 million?
Well, at this point in time.
At this point.
Now, Jerry can fill you in on that if you want to just quickly. We're going to wait, but let's just go ahead and do it really quick.
No, that's okay.
Or should we wait? At this point, it's $7 million, but we're trying to get that tightened up based on what David Kramer said about making sure you know everything and then tighten it up.
Right.
We don't want anybody to come back later and saying, well, why didn't you tell us that it was this, that, or the other thing?
Right. But what I'm getting at is of that $7 million in your... How much did you say was a part of your request of the 1.184?
172,000 this year. And I think when we forecasted it out over the 5 years is about $1 million. over the 5 years in the cap plan. I think we figured out it's about $1 million.
So that would be $5 million. If it's $1 million every 5 years. Or for 5 years.
For 5 years of $1 million that we could take out of cap if we did the bond issue stuff.
So
over the 5 years.
All right.
So this year would be 172.
That's what I did. Right.
Next year is probably 300,000. You know, it all balances to about.
Oh, not
million.
$1 million a year.
No.
$1 million over that 5 years.
Over the 5 years.
Well, that's okay. So I was thinking, how'd you get. Okay,
no,
I got
172 it. This year. Next year, I think I looked at it quickly. It's 108 or 380. Following year, it'll be something, but
right.
In
okay,
aggregate,
gotcha.
It's $1 million.
Okay.
So if we had the 500,000 back with the 700,000 that's there, that would make the capital improvement budget $1.2 million.
Chris? So what are we going to say to the assessor's office? Because, you know, this is a thing that I don't want to even hear. But I'm just saying, how do you set this up for this GIS discussion? Because if we don't do this next year, then my thought is the whole next year is this discussion of how do you make this GIS thing happen cleanly, whatever it's going to do, and facilitate that out. Because I just can hear her screaming, okay. Don't give me no more money. We just had this thing from Turk, da da da, all this stuff like that. And I just want to make sure there's a good counter somehow.
Well, I would be willing to, like maybe you and maybe you as chair of the finance, we sit down one more time with Diane and see if we can negotiate something.
Well, I mean, I just don't even know where to, because her whole attitude in here is like, you know, her
guy's
this.
Well,
guy
I know,
this,
but right. I mean, I think maybe. If she sees we're willing to give a little and she's willing to maybe move a little bit. I mean, it would be one more shot because it has to, we just, I mean, I think the board has not taken a formal position, but from what I'm hearing and when we've had discussions is that everybody believes the GIS and the assessor's office should belong under the GIS, countywide GIS. And that's just kind of where we are with it. And so how do we get from point A to point B? Well, let's sit down one more time and say this is budget time. This is what we'd like to do. Would you work with us on this?
So we gonna buy, we gonna buy GIS.
Yes.
Or what we could tell her is that, okay, but you know, Diane, you're not getting your $250,000, but if you give up your GIS, we'll keep your budget where it is today. And then all of a sudden, you know, you won't have these four positions, but you'll have the same budget. You're
so we'll assume
right.
The cost of putting
right.
Them in there.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah.
So that basically
what
is increased.
That's we talked about last time.
That basically is in, okay.
Right.
So that's the deal we offer.
No, that's it. But yeah, basically we assume the cost of those four employees coming over there.
Well, I don't. You know, I think one would retire. I don't know about
one would retire. Okay. So we said, but we're going to assume whatever cost of the great.
Well, in the space.
Yeah, into Dornicky's. Into Dornicky's area.
Right, that's where we would go.
Yeah.
We go.
But I mean, that's personnel, because
I mean,
I don't know if you.
That.
So you might lose
yeah.
One.
Yeah,
but
retire.
We're going to assume the personnel. We're going to assume the cost. That cost is personnel, space, and all that.
Right, and Joe, did you break out the amount that was for GIS in the assessors? And we can get that before we actually have the meeting with them.
I thought. I got to go back somewhere or another. I
yeah.
Thought I had that number. It's four positions, and I thought all in something. It was between $300,000 or $400,000.
I can't remember.
If I may, it was $333,000.
Yeah.
Thank you.
That memory is like stealing.
Well, I'm just saying, cause, so basically the trade-off is you keep that, but we're basically buying it.
Yep.
And we'll take it and make it work from there on out.
Yeah,
so the question is, how do we budget that through? Does that happen on a 6-month basis or a year basis? Because I'm fine in doing it to do it, because that, you know.
Well, it's not going to happen in 3 weeks. We know that.
Yeah,
right.
That's what I'm saying. So if it's 6 months.
6 months.
I'll believe it when I see it. Even in 6 months.
I'm fine with offering that deal. And the only caveat she can use it for, you know, renovation of physical renovation, you gotta be personnel.
Doug, do you have any thoughts on this GIS that you want to share? You don't have to.
I think it's a good idea to merge them all in one place, but I did have a question. Now, what is the date that the budget has to be finalized in June?
It doesn't have to be in June.
September.
It could be a lot later, but we want to get it done.
Yeah, we like to go in, you know, the fiscal year starts July 1st, so we like to go in, so start the year with all the department managers knowing what their budget's going to be.
But it could be September, technically, legally, it could be September.
I don't think we've ever, in the recent past, approved it any later than August 1st.
Historically.
Not recent, but used to.
But I mean recently.
Yeah.
But there's a public hearing in June, isn't there? There used to be.
Well.
Yeah.
Yeah, once we're ready to go, once the commissioners, you know, have consensus on what they'd like it to be, then it'll get published and there'll be a public hearing.
It wasn't until like the second week in July last year. Yeah. So, I mean, the most important thing is to get it right. If we're a little bit late, then.
Yeah.
Right.
So the public hearing is in July.
We don't know yet. It depends on if we're ready to go.
Okay.
We should be ready. Anything?
Well, we're in the process right now of hiring 4 deputy sheriffs that will replace 4 retirees. This reduction of 275 will mean that we'll have to stop that process. We do have money in the forfeiture account, but most of that is obligated under contract to pay for a records management system and to pay for crime lab accreditation. There will be some money left in that, but it won't be enough to cover the 275. So my concern is that we're 95-96% payroll. We have nowhere to cut other than people.
And how much of that,
Sure.
How much of that reduction do you think could be covered or not covered? You don't have to tell me today. Just go back and then let Joe know.
And maybe those 4 that are leaving, maybe, you know, the replacement, some of that sort of thing. Would be a little bit slower.
Wouldn't they be coming in at a lower salary if they're new?
Sure.
They would. They would be coming at a lower. And our hiring process, of course, if somebody leaves, let's say in January, their replacement won't be ready to go for probably more than a year. Because we have to have moral associates do our testing, which is twice a year. And then we have to time it with the Grand Island Training Academy, which is 4 months. And then when they get back, they have to be trained for 4 months in the field. So there's a long delay that's built in every time we rehire.
Okay. All right. You want to move to the bond?
Okay. All right. So the second,
Yes.
The second part of the discussion is a little update on the bond, and I think 2 things we want to talk about today is I know there's been some discussion with outside groups that could potentially be bond supporters, and we were having a discussion. First, Commissioner Kavanaugh requested some data that we could share with them, and then I think we came up with something basic, and maybe Patrick's been working on that and putting together more of a detailed, comprehensive talking piece. So the first point of discussion is, you know, where we are in that process, and once we have this talking piece together, how we envision using it going forward.
Marianne has.
Well, I think before that, Joe, I think I have not yet sensed the real solid consensus of what's in the budget.
Oh, that was the other point. Yeah, we could talk
about
that.
So before we go to the other,
that's fine.
That's one of the things that concerns me, is because we've been a moving target on this thing since we started talking about it. So from my recollection from the last meeting, the conversation was scrap. Again, there wasn't a full consensus, but scrap, treasurer, and environmental services. That's how some felt. And just leave corrections and 911. But then there were some who said scrap everything except for 911. To me, no matter what this bond issue ends up being, it's going to be tough. It is going to be tough. But I think we need to solidify where we are and what we want in it and what amount it's going to be. And then we'll come back around once the Finance Committee has figured out what to do in terms of how do we solidify an outside group to help us market it.
Yeah, and if you were planning to run for office right now, you'd be sure you had your manager and some other things all set. We don't have anything. We don't have really, to my knowledge, anybody ready to step up and help get this going and figure out where's there some funds to make certain public's aware of the priorities. And we've got to get those together. Jim, you wanted to ask something?
I said, yeah, I think that Mary Ann's right. We need to determine what's in the package going forward. I mean, how do we know what we're selling unless we know what we're selling? And, you know, the discussions that we've had in this committee and Administrative Services Committee relative to that have, and I think everybody's received the information on that, encompassed a bond issue in the $43 to $45 million range. The lower number is reflected in the fact that Patrick pointed out, I think, in our last discussion that we had a separate line item for $2.7 million in replacement radios for corrections in the sheriffs, which should actually be included in the $15 million item for 9/11 equipment. And Sheriff Wheeler picked a great time to walk out.
But that's
is
not
that,
here.
That's true.
It was supposed to be in the $15 million and then it was split out. So
that gets us from 45 to 43, but that said, that includes $35.3 million in construction costs and 9/11 costs. That's $20 million for construction costs, 20.3 actually, and $15 million for equipment costs, including this $2.7 million radio replacement. That construction component includes the 9/11, which is the bulk of it, 11,754 square feet. The Treasurer Branch and Department of Motor Vehicles, which is 8,989 square feet. Environmental Services, which is 2,498 square feet. And Emergency Management, that is 2,400 square feet. Now, of those, and the testimony at these meetings specifically on these points of their directors, everything but Treasurer is public safety. Where Environmental Services has flooding duties that they perform in conjunction with 9/11 and the other first responders that we have. Emergency Management obviously is all about public safety because they only go in case of emergencies. So when we talked in a previous one about segregating out some, you know, bright line, the public safety component of this, all you're really talking about is the treasurer's component. And as I think Commissioner Morgan pointed out, you don't do a building, you know, halfway. You don't do half of the roof, half of the plumbing, half of the electricity. If you're not going to use the whole building, you bring it out to code, the vanilla box, and then you use the portion that you're going to use, which is going to be, at the very least, everything but the treasurer's DMV component. That said, we're still looking at essentially the same construction costs, maybe a little off to not do the final finish on the treasurer DMV component, but final finish on everything else, and $7 million for the corrections costs, which again is offset in some part by the deferred maintenance question that we just talked about. So if you factor all those things in, and we, believe me, we're trying every time we have an Administrative Services Committee to get that number to a finite number, and this month's will be an even closer number, somewhere below what we talked about last time in terms of the even $43 million number.
Right.
So if I had to say today, I would say that we are in the maybe $40 million plus or minus range rather than the $45 million range, and it could be less than that. Hopefully, we will have everybody, all the stakeholders at the next Administrative Services Committee with even closer numbers. I mean, every time we do this, every pass that we have at this, we get better and better numbers. But if you look at the last document that was made available on May 24th, you'll see the breakout, both the macro and the individual component breakout on that document. And that said, I think that, you know, conceptually we've got a fair idea of what's in the public safety bucket. If anybody doesn't, then, you know, let's talk about it now. But say we do everything but the Treasurer, Department of Motor Vehicle thing, that's a fair idea. And the sheriff's thing, we throw those guys under the bus too.
We're back on.
We were just talking about the public safety bond, and the component that came directly to your shop was the $2.7 million that we had for replacement of radios for corrections and sheriffs is actually folded into the 9/11 $15 million cost number. I think you're on board with that. Is that right?
Yes.
Yes. Yes. Sheriff's office understands that that's the way it is. Yes?
I understand that.
Okay. What's the emergency management amount?
Emergency management is in the $20.3 million build out for 2,400 square feet.
In the Fitzgerald?
Yes.
So we're moving them out
to sea level, out of sea level.
Out of sea level.
Which is what I've been wanting to do for a long time.
And we'll get numbers on the vanilla box. We'll probably be talking about this almost every week, I just think, on the bonds.
So
next Tuesday again.
To your point, what is going to be our cutoff date with a number?
Well, I think
whatever starts has to start after Labor Day.
We have to start publishing in the paper, which what is that, 60 or 90 days before?
It's going to be July.
November,
it has to be July.
July or August.
You know, Bellevue just was on last night.
Yeah.
For September.
$75 million.
And did you see what they
August
showed?
1st.
Boilers? Did you see that?
Yeah. August.
See what they focused
shoot
on?
For August 1st.
August 1st?
Okay. Yeah, let's shoot for August 1st. And then if I could, I'd like Jerry to
quit. Wait. We'll back that up. If you do it August 1st, that's 60 days before what?
The election.
Approximately.
That's 90.
You could say August
something.
99. Whatever, 4th or whatever it is. I don't know when the election, November 7th or 6th.
November 5th.
So then August.
Yeah.
90 days prior to.
Yes, you have certain publishing requirements where you
right.
have to go public with who's going to be on the ballot. Or,
right.
Yeah.
But, you know, that's what the bond council tells us. But I know there's a certain X number of days before it's on the general election you have to, you know, publish. What's going to be on the ballot, and when we publish that, what's going to be on the ballot, it has to be the amount and what it's for.
And all I can tell you is the mood of the people, Mike was with me on some of this, the mood of the people with the 7%, 75,000 households, it's pretty negative toward anything. I mean, and Doug, you two may want to speak up to this too. But we need to have it in order and figure out how we're going to do it, get it out there and make it happen. Did you have something?
Well, but again, that was my point at the beginning, is that now what's being read by Commissioner Kavanaugh is different than what the Finance Committee talked about from last time. So all I'm saying is that we have to, at some point, stop talking and say this is what's in the bond issue.
Period.
Okay, I have an update that may be a factor in this. As far as corrections, we've got professionals looking into the $7 million number which is comes from the advice of the bond council. Get somebody professionally, find out what you need of corrections, and we'll put it in the bond. Now, we've got seven in there. I wish it was six. It may be nine. But it will be not Jeff and I. It will be a professional telling us what we've got to deal with at corrections. Now,
and is everybody in agreement that corrections will
right.
be in?
But people
yeah.
said no to it the last time
no.
I remember.
That's what you
me.
Have to decide.
Right.
What's the number, or not the number, when's the date you think you'll have some numbers back from that professional?
The end of this month.
June.
So
that's
Jim,
July.
Is your meeting 21st or 28th?
It's the 28th. Next. Yeah,
it's the 28th.
Can we do the 28th? We could have it back. Is that what Al said?
It doesn't matter if we don't want it in there.
No, it's correction, so.
I know, but that's what I'm
oh.
saying is that the last meeting that we had of this finance committee, there were people who said no to corrections.
I'm not
being,
hearing them today.
I'm not sure the majority of
well, I thought you said it, too.
Correction?
Yeah.
No,
okay,
but
Kramer is, I mean, if it's, it can class off.
So
yeah,
we might.
I thought it was Blair.
Yeah, we could
it's
have
it.
I'm trying
it.
To do it without
being
in.
For
now,
your discretion, it looks like I'm under the bus.
Okay.
I haven't shared
I
this.
We have some. No, I've got a few reservations. I think we need to be talking about it next Tuesday again when we have our meeting after the board meeting and continue to work toward a consensus, even though we're going to have the 28th. But I'm concerned about it. I'm really concerned that the deal.
Oh, yes, that's
passed.
What we tell you. Can I mean, so
go ahead.
I'm just saying my only concern is the parallel. We need the parallel track of what he's saying about the whole organization. I mean, I think I don't care what that number is. I care what it is, but meaning we haven't talked internally about this parallel group of like a chairman for it, the people involved for it, and I think we got to do that now to your point. That can't wait until we pass resolution. We need to be ready to put those people in the room so when it's passed, they're ready to go and hit it.
Well, I know Jim and Mike have been talking to the first responders. I've talked to a few people that don't want to help or be involved in it because there are too many things going on and,
yeah.
you know, so on. You know, and I don't know where the first responders are. Go ahead.
I think that we should have, by the end of the month, a fair idea of the costs as good as we can get them on these components. I don't know of anybody other than Mike who had an objection to this package, with the exception of Mike having an objection to non-public safety components. So at the last meeting when we talked about this, I called Mark Fox all up and I said, Mark, are you public safety? And he kind of said, yes, of course I am. Same with environmental services. Same with emergency services. They're all tied into public safety. So we're going to do a public safety bond. Those components on these numbers that have been circulating freely for over a month are the components that we're talking about. We'll get better numbers as we go forward.
No.
How do you
environmental
get
services is clearly
service.
Not public
exactly.
safety.
Oh, yes.
They do flooding. I came into county government when there was a huge flood. Sorry, in your district, big floods. Floods on the Papio Creek.
But is that NRD?
No, it's Environmental Services. And we should have these guys in here, you know, for this meeting because they come to the Administrative Services Committee meetings and you can check the minutes and they talk about their public safety acts.
The flood
specifically.
He used to work there, so he could talk to
them. He wanted to talk about the first responders by the original discussion that you and I had. If you'll recall, was we need to have a community support mechanism like the OPS people did on their big honking bond issue. And in order to do that, we need to solicit the support of community leaders. And we've gone out, I think both of us, maybe more than just you and I, and talked to people about the possible participation of them in the public campaign to support this bond issue. The first responders whose sole mission is to help public safety in this area have been approached and asked for some additional information, which we've supplied to them, and Patrick, I think, is working on some
yes,
supplemental information
yeah.
for them as well. But, you know, that's not limited to them or to me or to you. I mean, I think if we want this bond issue to pass, we can't do what was done last time, which is no community support, no independent committee, no solicitation of anybody to do anything at all to support that bond issue. So those are the two things. So that, you know, we'll have better numbers than this, but these are the numbers we're the best numbers that we've got today, and the community support is, you know, I think incumbent on all of us who want to have the bond issue passed to try to get.
Mike has been out to the first responders. I know.
Yes, he has.
And do you expect that they need to know a number before they want to get totally involved?
Yeah, I mean, we've sent them the best number that we have.
And how?
Which is this number, which is this document.
How do they react?
They've got some questions. They have a question for Joe about our bond rating and how we are set up, and I think we satisfactorily answered that. They have some questions about the application of these improvements independent of the 9/11. We gave them 9/11 information. And so now they want to know about the other components. Patrick's working on that.
Yes. Good to have them maybe next Tuesday or the week after to talk or listen and let you answer some questions. It's up to you and Mike. I leave that to you. Okay, I'm not sure who was first, Chris, first, and Mark, then Patrick. Well,
What is environmental services amount and how does that qualify as public safety?
It's public safety.
Jerry can talk to you because he used to work.
Do you want
to?
Yeah,
I mean, okay. I'm willing to accept the stress with emergency management, but if it's for them,
There's two differences with regards to environmental services and public safety. There's rural flooding in western Douglas County, nothing to do with the NRD. It's all on us. Would you agree?
Yeah.
Soco Camp,
yeah.
Valley, Waterloo,
yeah.
etc. That's under Kent.
Mm-hmm.
Second component is. And I've been there for that, tornado of 75, blizzard of 75. The landfill is critical in a disaster.
So you just basically talking about covering flooding as public safety.
And natural disasters.
And disasters, okay. which would fit also with emergency management.
You cannot put that in.
No.
That is an internal, inside game definition of public safety. They will spit that out and say no. That I'm just telling you, that's the same example that Miller did when they did their first bond issue, and they included security and they wanted football fields and everything like that.
Oh yeah, they would. Yeah.
But I'm just saying, when you say public safety, they're gonna say that's flooding. That is not that. That is gonna get us done.
Yeah, I'm totally with Chris.
Okay.
And I think seeing all of that flooding and
I mean, particularly with the NRD and that whole, it was that bond issue was just on the primary and it barely passed. You want to put a poison pill in there?
No, they got beat, didn't they?
Their bonding authority went down.
Okay, well, the window. Sorry, I last kind of I didn't.
I think it barely passed in Douglas County.
Okay, then I forgot all the other places, but still, that was close.
That will kill it.
Because they already said no. They're gonna see that again, and that will ruin everything.
Some good money and big money behind it was six-figure numbers.
Now, and the emergency management, quite frankly, I was willing to swallow it then until I heard the environmental piece. But improving that building just for that, and I know you want to get them out, but I think you got to get these radios and stuff through so before you can even play. And even if you have to look into getting them out and rent some space somewhere else. I think putting it in there is shaky.
Okay, could I throw out a revised number that I prepared, but not enough for a handout?
Sure.
$42.3 million. So we're going down, and the reason for that is what Commissioner Kavanaugh said. We had the discussion with 911. I think Tom was a part of that with Jenny. We agreed that we may have double-clicked there on the radios. Okay. So now we're down to 42.3. Now we get into a serious discussion, maybe not today. If you combine those environmental service and emergency management, 5,000 square feet, you take it out, and we develop it through the cap, because now you've upped the cap. So it's not in the bond. So now we could get lower. Then it could be a serious public safety bond.
Yep. Okay, Patrick, did you still want to talk?
Just real quick, the people that you were talking, Commissioner Kavanaugh was talking to, what's the guy's name?
Ray Sombrick.
Ray Sombrick. Okay, three questions. One, what is the benefit to the taxpayers of each item you want to include in the bond issue? Two, what do you want our group to do to participate? What specifically are you asking us to do? Three, if we have any out-of-pocket expenses, how are those going to be handled? How are we going to be reimbursed for out-of-pocket expenses? I don't see any out-of-pocket expenses, but to the extent there are, it would have to be through money raised by that committee. I'm in the process of getting information for question one, got some information from Kent, got some information from Paul Johnson, and I'm waiting for information from Mark Foxall on corrections. So that's where we're at.
Okay,
did
you have something?
Go ahead.
No, I don't.
Go ahead, Jim.
And I got a call from Ray today asking where we are on that. I think that the first one was actually phrased, what are the benefits to public safety?
Okay.
And they are very public safety oriented. The other two are not relevant to the administration of this county answering. They're not going to be involved in the promotion of this bond issue. We heard from bond counsel that we need to have an independent committee do that. We're not using county resources, we're not using county personnel to go out in the community and promote that. And so I pointed out to Ray, and Patrick is aware of this as well because I CC'd him on it, that the only thing that we're talking about from the county is what's the public policy, the public safety reasons that we're doing this. Second thing I would say is, anything on this list that you're not doing with the bond issue, you're gonna end up doing with property taxes. I am against property tax increases to do these items. They will fit into this bond issue, and if you don't want to do them in the bond issue, then you're saying you want to do them on property tax increases, and I'm not going along with that.
No, not saying that.
Chris?
It's not a fact of saying you want to do it on property tax. It's a fact of what realistically you can get through. And I think what you're saying is the decision has already been made is you committed to the extra reserve to do whatever you want to do capital-wise. That, now, I'm not saying Paul and those guys are important. I'm not saying that. But what I'm saying is if you have to move them to another place because of that and it's that much of a concern, do. But on the margins, environmental services will get picked out and taken to NRD territory. And once one word of mouth takes that there, you're battling not promoting the bond issue, but battling what it's not. And emergency management in their eyes is not seen as that. I know you want to get them out. That's a want. That's not a need. And if you don't get the need, which is the equipment, you'll be in a bigger property tax fix next year. So you got to wheel this thing down and base it on its purity. So I'm not saying it's done without that, but I'm saying Paul and those guys might have to hold off on it.
Mr. Kraft?
Emergency management is definitely public safety. In case there's a tornado, in case there's...
But Patrick, the heart of what you want to do is move them out of the basement.
And he said it's possible we could do it with cap money, capital improvement money, still at the FITS home.
Still be at the FITS, no, just come out of a different pot.
Moving them out the basement is not public safety. They're going to operate. And if it was an issue, if they had a flood, it's an inconvenience. But it's going to be a bigger inconvenience if stuff that is really not essential is in there and this thing goes down. It could go down either way with just the public safety stuff. But you're not going to be able to explain to them. When the questions I ask is for emergency management, what's this for? To move them out of this building to that building. That's not public safety. And somebody's going to put that together.
That's exactly what we're doing at 9/11. We're moving them from one building to another.
Yeah, but that's well, but, not one
but the expansion is
co-locating
needed.
Co-locating them. There's a benefit to co-locating them.
There's a need for that expansion of 911.
You can just, but 911 has some equipment too. All right. That's a bigger deal.
Well, I want to back up a minute because the statement you made is that if I don't agree with putting this in the bond issue, I'm agreeing to a property tax increase. And that's really not true because the bond issue that's passed, approved by the voters, has a direct impact on what our mill levy is anyway. So it's all eventually the same pot of money. So it's how and when you do it. And what, again, what I'm trying to stay focused on is the fact that this is going to be tough to begin with. And I felt consensus last time was true public safety being 911 and corrections, except for, I guess it was just Mikey that agreed with that. And so that is where I think we should stick with it and go with it so that we get off this dime of keep going to different committees and talking about it and adding and deleting and adding and deleting. Let's just say that that's what we're going to do with 911 and corrections. And there's a gentleman.
You know, this is very interesting, guys. My name is Jim Sasma. I'm a retired aviation safety inspector for the FAA, and I'm sitting here listening to numbers. And I'm here taking a completely different perspective than what you guys are seeing here. And just to what I've been able to perceive at this point in time, you guys are supposed to be running the city. Is that not
county.
Correct?
County.
County.
I don't know. Oh, that's bigger. Yeah, man. So we have some responsibilities here, correct? You know, what I'm perceiving in this group, and Morgan popped up a while ago and said something, you know, the bond issue, people, all they're gonna see here is you guys spending money. I've heard public safety mentioned probably 20, 30 times here. Well, public safety, that's the deal. I'm looking at this deal here, it says expense budget request. Now, what doesn't really make sense to me is here, we've got two things here. We've got corrections, $37 million, and yet we've got sheriff, $15 million. You know, corrections, why are we spending that kind of money on corrections? What all does that entail here? Guys, that's a lot of money. That's just not pocket change. And yet, we have a sheriff's department here, which budgets a whole lot less than half what that is. Now, if you guys want to do
Jim,
some good with this.
What that is if I can.
Sure.
The corrections is where we house over 1,400 people, and 1,400 are released and probably 1,400 brought in every month. And the fact is we don't get reimbursed from the state. So if someone commits a crime in Marianne or Chris, someone else can say
so I can't rent space from that.
It's all city prisoners too.
The heart of that is, you know, the constitutional responsibility for the jail. Part of it, big part of it is employees, and that's housed there, and it's a 24-hour facility.
Sure.
That's
a lot of money, sure.
Huh?
Which is
seems
a lot
like
more employees than
the
sheriff's
sure. Well,
department.
Of course it's a grand
money.
Yeah, a lot more employees.
But that's like one of
the
main.
Yeah.
And we, by statute, we have to do that, and we've got to be so careful about the safety of our people and the inmates at the same time.
Well, I'm
state
gonna be
used to reimburse us, they don't any longer. It probably stopped, what, 6 years ago thereabouts?
Yeah, but it's the biggest, but I mean, prison is an accumulation, but facility, it's the biggest facility in the state.
Yes.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Large
okay, Jim,
it's the biggest
ahead.
Mental health facility in the state.
Right.
Too.
That's right.
Keep
that's
going, just, Jim.
That's just appalling to me as a taxpayer here.
What's that?
I've been living in Omaha since 1967, and I've seen a lot of changes in our fine community here. We're still living here, and we'll continue. My rent that I pay to the county for the house we live in.
What's appalling to you, the amount or?
The what now?
What's appalling to you, the amount?
Yeah.
That's actually cheap.
Cheap?
Yes.
My compared rent on my house?
No, the
no.
The
we
cost
keep raising it every year.
The cost of
the cost of jail. The cost of that jail is being contained by a lot of other actions of trying to get people out. With community programs.
You and I
like
could
that.
Talk offline here
we
about
can.
That for hours and
yeah,
maybe you
can. I can give it to you, Bob.
Okay.
Go ahead.
Yeah. We, as a community here, are passing something here. There's hundreds, if not thousands, of guys of my vintage. Came from a different world, you know, walk of life businesses. And there's hundreds, if not thousands, of us. That this body of people, and I've talked to Gene Stothard about this, is taking advantage of these senior citizens out here. You know, you see them in coffee shops talking and whatnot, and get their ideas and whatnot in small groups, if not dozens, hundreds of them, whatnot, and have meetings. We used to have meetings like that years ago. We've kind of got away from that. But you can glean a ton of information on how to address some of these issues that we've got here.
You want to ask something?
Well, I just want to say that I am all for that, and I think this board has actually been ahead of the curve, and I hope Doug agrees with me, because Doug came kind of the same silk that you are, of being totally appalled at how we were spending our money. And I asked him if he would spend an evening with me to go over our budget so that he understood what was mandated, what was not mandated, and why we still did it. And God bless him, he did. We spent 4 hours going through the budget. And every year he does bring a white paper that we seriously look at, but there are some things that we just can't do because of state law. So I would be more than happy to have you invite me to a group of senior citizens, especially because I agree that that population is growing, their income is decreasing, and yet we have all of these other issues that have to be funded but through their property tax dollars, because that's where we get the bulk of our revenue. So I'm saying to you right now, you put a group together, I'll be there to talk to you and go through anything, ask anything that you want to ask.
Well, you guys here, you're not dumb people, you're smart people, and you've got a deal you're dealing with here on how to attack something here. And it's just, I came down today as a guest of Doug's to say, hey, how are we going to do this? What are you guys going to do? And I'm sitting here listening to this, wanting to climb up here, you know.
And that's just, good. That's good.
Because the population is made up of people, and I'm kind of lecturing here. 10% of the people make things happen, 40% watch, and there's 50%. Then I have a clue what's going on here. And you can go out in public and you can see that. This body here is part of the 10%ers to make things happen here. Now, this bond thing that's coming in, you're going to sell this to the people of how we're going to save money. Well, they're looking at, God, are you people smoking marijuana or something here? Because all you're doing is spending. Right. You're not showing people, American people like myself, how it's going to save money in 5-10 years from now. You guys are going to spend money on improvements, maintenance, right? Why have we not been doing that all along here?
Because we've been cutting their budgets because of the pressures of reducing, trying to keep property tax, trying to keep our mill levy lower. And so at the urging of our CAO, of our chief financial officer, they kept saying it's going to come in our public properties people. They kept saying this is going to come back and bite you.
Yeah.
It is going to bite you. And we kept saying, let's just keep limping along. Let's do what we can when we can. And so we kept increasing them a little bit, but kept putting stuff off.
Kept kicking the can down the road.
We didn't want to raise the tax rate.
Right. So we didn't.
That was the alternative.
Right.
Sure.
So, one time out of 6 years, we've raised the mill levy. And that was on a 4-3 vote. One time. The other thing you have to realize is we continue. We don't have sales tax or any other revenue source. Only property taxes, which we get roughly 13% of whatever you pay, okay? Now, what I want you to realize is when a tenant sold the hospital St. Joe that had $60 million of value, they paid property taxes. Coco's on 87th and Dodge, or the buildings on 85th, 87th and Cass, the HDR building soon, the three that were bought by Children's are going to be bought shortly, it's been announced. All that goes off the tax rolls and affects us. We lose hundreds of millions of dollars because they're bought by medical. None of the hospitals pay property taxes. If they buy a building, they put their people in it, the Blue Cross Blue Shield buildings, put the medical practices in there, no more property taxes. We keep losing on that situation.
But we need your help, Jim.
Morgan, I understand that. Hey, everybody's after this buck here.
Right.
But you know something? Your guys' job isn't becoming easier. It's becoming more difficult.
Right.
Because our community is still growing.
Right.
Still growing.
And the needs are still there.
Oh, yeah.
And the public. So that's why having you become a partner with us as a taxpayer so that you completely understand why are we going after this bond issue? Why are we going to the taxpayers to ask them for an increase due to the needs of the county in this public safety arena? So you being here or you being a part of those discussions is vital.
This young man right here was talking earlier, you know, with numbers and whatnot. He's pretty sharp, you know, because he's got two sets of books here. He gives you guys numbers from one set of books, and he's dealing over here in another set of books. I understand that game here. Now, let's take this and make this all work here. But when you go sell this, Morgan said earlier, and I'm repeating myself here, it'll never fly unless you sell this to the people that, by God, we're going to save money down the road here.
That's what we're trying to accomplish through determining what we want in the bond issue, what the cost is going to be, and then how is that going to benefit the taxpayers in the long run. Absolutely right. You're absolutely right.
So we that's why discussion was about getting next environmental services
so
out.
So you help us, right?
Yeah. Go again, yeah.
No, that's what we're saying. Environmental services is not public safety.
I don't agree. What you're watching is us cashing out in a public forum. We are more open than any other
government
finance
body.
Committee on any government body I've ever seen.
I commend you guys for this. Really.
Thank you. And we are extremely transparent. Now, part of this is not saving money. Part of it is expanding 911. It has dramatically outgrown the facilities in. The other part of it is, so we need to have a bigger building. There's no way to expand in the building we're in. The other part of it is the equipment we have is, as of 2017, is that correct?
2018 is end of life.
2018 will no longer be supported. Parts will not be available for Motorola. They've already let us know.
There's also
the need for the new radios because they won't meet with the new requirements of intercommunication between different departments. Now, none of that saves us money, but it's all vitally important to public safety. Yep. If you call up 911 and say, hey, somebody's at my door and I think they've got a gun, you want a response. The sheriff, if you're outside the city limits, the city will respond. Do you live inside or outside the city limits?
I live by the West Road, sir.
Okay. Take away, when you're looking at, I'm going to go back. When you're looking at taxes and you hear that Nebraska is 24th out of the 50 states in taxes, people think of even lines between the taxes. Back in 2001, we were considered the eighth highest taxing state. The difference between the eighth highest taxing state in 2001 and the ninth highest was a penny per capita for $1,000 of income. Not much, is it? It's all the bell-shaped curve. From the eighth highest to the, or actually it was from the fifth highest to the 48 was all within a few points. There was about I don't remember the numbers anymore. I hate to admit this, 2001 was a few days ago. But there was not a huge gap. So we can't look at, oh, by the way, if you were to, in 2001, factor out the garbage pickup fee you pay in your taxes, since Omaha is one of the few cities that is required by state law to pick up garbage and yard waste throughout the nation, we would have dropped from 8th highest to 24th highest back in 2001.
Okay, I appreciate what you're saying here, but we're taking up these guys' time here, and they probably want to get out of here.
Sure. But I did want to explain that to you. It's not as dire as some people think. You know, the numbers.
Well, I know my rent keeps going up in the county.
Yeah, and unfortunately, we got hit with that 7%.
I understand that. But, you know, if you tell people if you're going to do this bond issue, you're going to have to be honest and upfront that, hey, we're trying to save 20, 30, 50 million down the road here. You know, why not instead of kicking the can?
That's what we're trying to do here. That's what we're hashing out.
Okay, I'll wait patiently as the weeks progress here.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks.
No, be a part of it. Keep coming.
And you've got the offer.
Yeah,
if she
absolutely.
Can't make it, I will, or Jim, or Claire, or Mark,
or myself, yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Why don't we kind of conclude, unless we have some things that we need to do. I think we'll talk about it again next Tuesday, but we need to start to wrap it up. Jim, you and Mike, think about if you want to have the first responders here to ask some questions, being in a discussion. What else do we have next Tuesday after the board besides talking about the bond a little bit, and we should limit the time?
The bond and the budget.
Okay. But the budget, we kind of got things in front of us, so commissioners need to kind of look at that and have other suggestions.
Or say you're okay with it.
Yeah.
And I'm pretty okay with what Joe's brought. But
we're adding infrastructure stuff though, right? With the infrastructure.
Yeah. 500,000.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank
you all very much. And Jim was right. He said you're